Anyone who had driven through Hudson in the 70s, 80s, even the early 90s, I think it'd be hard not to be perplexed by what you saw. And it always stuck in my mind as a place, you know, I've got to go check out that town, Hudson, someday, because something really screwy is going on there. Hudson's really this postage stamp sized city. It's about 2 miles square and 7,500 people.
Up there is the old Hudson Orphanage. It was an insane asylum and an orphanage, and now it's a library.
Rich history, Henry Hudson, you know, waterfront, you know, lost by one vote as the state capital. Yeah, you didn't know that, did you?
Of course, this is the block where, in the 18th century, the sperm oil works were. It was the smelliest part of Hudson. It's where they put the first school and the first whorehouses.
Hudson's got a bad reputation. Even people who live, you know, just over the, you know, the county line, you know, think Hudson is this place where you just buy crack and get a $20 blowjob.
It's not gay, it's not straight, it's not hippies, it's not bikers, it's a little bit of everything.
Blacks, the Spanish, Bangladesh, Asians, Hawaiians.
That's why it's like the Bermuda Triangle of like melting pot here. It's like something happens when you get in here, it's different from other communities.
Yeah, you know, there's a great deal about America that you just have to love. And it's right here, all around you. And then there's that bit of America that makes you want to go crazy and shake somebody, and it's all here right around you.
I guess that's what the best part about Hudson is. It is really a mirror of America.
I was born in Hudson, 1954. Hudson was a little different then. Main Street was like something out of Andy of Mayberry. It was, you know, kind of like a blue-collar town, river town. And then when these strip malls and everything started coming in, you know, a lot of the shops became empty on Warren Street.
I mean, I can remember delivering mail on Warren Street and just crack houses all up and down Warren Street. I mean, it was terrible. You know, in the 80s, I mean, when I would open a door, I would go like this, and I would look in, you know, what's gonna come out? You know, something like this. I mean, what am I gonna bump into when I go in this doorway? I mean, that's not the case anymore. You know, as I go around now and I see, you know, I'll see these old homes that were like in tremendous decay, and now to just be right back, you know, to the original, the way they were. I just think it's such a cool place, and it can be so much, you know, it can be so much more. With just, you know, it's just right there. It's like ripe. It's, you know, it's gonna happen.
When we saw this house in 1985, and we thought, wow, they were selling it for nothing. It's so cheap, we couldn't buy a studio apartment in New York City for this. So we bought the house, and the next day after we closed, it was the front page article, most expensive house ever sold in Hudson.
We looked drove at the up street. The main street, and we're in awe.
Wendell loves to renovate wrecked
buildings. I was just drooling.
So we're going down the street, and I'm like, look, Wendell, oh my God, you can have a ball here.
We're really proud to say that we're about a month away from our grand opening. Hopefully, many of you will have a chance to come back and sample our Cajun cuisine and also the live entertainment that we plan to provide.
See, I'm still constructing some of this. There's some swinging doors yet to come.
Our neighbors, when we first came here, was almost like they're occupying this place.
We were
just this little occupation, this piece of land, and no one really knew what we were doing, but we had it
for the people.
Hi, lot of changes, especially on the main drag. They're charging the New York City prices. Two-bedroom apartment with a kitchen and a living room, $600-$700. That's crazy.
If you go into a neighborhood, or if you come into a city, you kind of ought to try to blend into the city, not turn the whole city around in 5 minutes, and make it what you want it to be.
One newspaper, Hudson was called the New Hamptons. And then town assessors see that, and they raise the real estate up. And it's pushed a lot of that, you know, black and white, you know, poor community, like, right down, pushing it right over to Front Street, moving it down further and further and further. And I know some of them that are hoping to get rid of that whole section.
What we're experiencing here in Hudson at the moment is disharmony among a group of people who have basically been here all their lives and a group of people that have perhaps discovered Hudson in the last 15 years.
Fishing now, he's swimming now. We could eat the fish. During that time, we could eat the fish out of the river. You can't eat them out of there now.
This man fished while he was blind. He gonna, God, that's my grandfather. He gonna, when God take him, he gonna have a fishing pole in his hand.
Fishbo, are you with me? Hometown is dead. It's Folks' town.
Boosie, come tell him about Hudson.
Welcome to my ghetto.
He's just a clown, that's all.
I'll put it in the garbage can. Don't drink out of that.
Have there been any changes since you've been here?
Yes, I've been here since 1956. In 56, everyone shared and helped each other. But now, the antique people, they bought everything up. They feel they buy a house, throw the people out. They think more of a piece of pottery and a piece of clay and a painting than they do a human life. And I'm tired of it. We would like to have antiques on our table, but I'll be damned if a Mickey Mouse clock that don't work is worth $1,500.
Pussy, they want the history of Hudson. They don't need your problems.
After 9/11, everybody trying to get out of New York City. But they got to put a housing code of what how high your rent could go, because the economy here doesn't pay for people to pay for the housing.
They're leaving
us
out.
There's no jobs around here. Where are people going
to
go?
We have to be included. They're not going to leave us out.
Hudson's history is sort of an up-and-down affair. It seems like the town's caught up in an endless cycle of boom and bust. Well, Hudson had an early economic base of whaling. When that industry faded, other industries came in. We had a leather goods factory called the Pocketbook Factory. We had a match factory here, Universal Match. There was a brewery here. We had two cement plants. One was called Atlas and one was called Lone Star. And they were huge employers. They employed about 2,500 people between the two of them. We had blue-collar jobs for folks, and many people raised their kids. They had a life here. And that sort of disintegrated. Some of the big industries went away. There was nothing to replace it. Hudson sort of lost itself. The town has been many different things, and it keeps reinventing itself, and it's in the process of doing that now. So for a small place of only 7,500 residents, it's actually a very exciting place to live.
It gets complex, and how do you untangle and
sort of set the course for a new idea in a city like Hudson, which is abandoned. Everybody left Hudson. Now everybody's coming back. Okay, we're all here now. What are we going to do? Are we going to just worry about our property and that our property goes up, up, up in value? Or are we going to really worry about the citizens who've been here and been left out? And that's, I think, ultimately my main concern.
Are you a U.S. citizen? Yes. Huh? Date of birth?
Position, what are you asking to do?
Driver.
Driver?
Quieter than here.
That's the position we should put? You can start immediately?
Yeah, anytime. Even though it's a small community, a lot of people don't speak to each other. It's an extremely divided community here. There's a lot of racism here. There's a lot of economic disparity.
Who to notify in case of emergency? Your wife?
You.
Me?
Yeah.
I got to take you to the hospital?
Yeah.
All right. Tell them you know me.
Okay. What goes on in Hudson really is a microcosm of what's going on in America.
Get the job.
Not enough people are crossing over the lines and having a conversation.
Where'd the projector go?
Okay. Is that fine? Leave it there?
Yeah.
You've been here all day with us to share in the long community event. Started last night, actually. You missed last night.
What's for breakfast?
bagels. For those of you who don't know, this is Claudia, my longtime associate and buddy, Claudia Green. We founded TSL in New York City in 1973, and while we were there,
we moved into buildings that no one thought were useful. We created theater spaces and churches and basements. We were probably the grand recyclers. Unfortunately, we were probably a little too good at it and recycled ourselves out of a home. When we arrived in Hudson, the whole question about who we were or what was our art changed radically.
So do we have a full house in there?
We still do a lot of regular arts programs.
But now we also do outreach programs, potluck suppers, political and multicultural events. Thank you all for coming today to celebrate the liberation of your country in Time and Space Limited.
Essentially, our goal is to bring as much of the community as we can together. In the 13 years we've been here, things have really turned around. I mean, there's a lot more opportunities and there's a lot more money coming into Hudson. But at the same time, it does create a lot of challenges for the community. I think the challenge now is to figure out how to spread some of that money around a little, legally.
Hudson pretty much was always a port, and there was always drugs, prostitutes, gambling going on in Hudson pretty much from its, you know, inception.
Yeah, there were 68 bars here in 1940. It was a fun time. They had everything here you wanted, gambling, prostitution, whatever.
Most of these houses along here, at one point or another, housed a brothel over the last 100 years or so. This one was Mae Gordon's house. Here's Mae Gordon and some of her employees. She was never a very attractive lady, always a little weight compromised. Here's Mae Gordon in her prime, very fetching in her underwear in her backyard. Here she is when she's a little more substantial. I believe by this time she'd stopped being a working girl herself and had moved into management.
Goodness. The people of Hudson allowed Hudson to become one of the prime things of prostitution and didn't raise an eyebrow. All my years of living with my grandmother down in Hudson, she never spoke against it because it was a way of life. Every once in a while, someone would run for mayor saying, "I'm going to clean up the city." And 3 months into office, somebody said, "You know, leave it alone, everybody's making money." It took Governor Dewey to sneak in at night with the state troopers and she finally put an end to it.
The first thing that they did actually was round up all the local police, and they locked them up in the local jail. They started bashing down doors, and you see men in their underwear and women in their underwear jumping into cars and trying to drive away. But in this house, they not only found a bunch of women and a bunch of Johns, they found two Hudson police officers in the kitchen eating steam clams. I think all but two of the police officers on the force were indicted for corruption, and the two cops that were actually found in the whorehouses were finally exonerated. One of them eventually became commissioner of police.
One night, not long after I moved here, having heard a lot of these kind of tall tales from residents about how corrupt our local government was, or about the police chief who, you know, had to resign for obstructing drug investigations, and all these kinds of stories that I had heard but didn't really, wasn't sure whether they should be believed or not. I think the turning point for me was when, you know, for lack of anything better to do, I went to a public meeting that I read about in the paper.
We have a person building a building on property they don't even own. And they applied for it, and the city issued a permit.
I got two issues. You had a meeting now, and they're building a new firehouse.
No.
Courthouse. And who's lying? What did you tell me the other day? Mistaken the other day. What did you tell me? The fuck?
When we negotiated it, it's for the firehouse, whatever's first.
Okay. What are you talking about? No.
We're negotiating. Hey. It's not in the contract. It's in the coaching.
They're not.
Yeah. I think that there are agreements that are made, and the processes to these agreements are not open to the public.
I was absolutely astonished by the passion and the engagement of the people in the audience.
I lived here all my life.
Who are trying to assert just their most basic rights to participate in a decision-making process with their local government.
You make it sound like I'm a member of the communist organization.
And the elected officials' blatant disregard for those citizens speaking out, that said to me, something is really wrong here. When I was in grade school, you know, we talked about how, you know, a lot of stuff that seems kind of quaint now about how anyone can become president and how everybody's vote counts, and the idea that through personal engagement that people can take responsibility for the place they live in and make a better place. To me, that's, you know, the element of that I've found very exciting in Hudson.
Industrial city that is totally out of scale with anything that's ever been contemplated here. It would be 20 million pounds of pollution a year coming from this facility. It would be the largest structure between the Adirondacks and Manhattan, with 400-foot stack, 6.5-mile plume, 2.5-mile conveyor system, 300 truckloads a day coming and going. Industrial-sized barges. It just doesn't fit.
I live right on the waterfront, actually. Yeah, 15 North Front Street. I see barges and trains all the time. It wakes me up at night, and I don't think there'd be any bigger impact than what's happening right at this time.
First discovered the project when a little postcard appeared in my mailbox from St. Lawrence Cement saying, "We'd like to be your neighbor." I don't particularly want to see our community impacted by a massive industrial facility run by a bunch of Swiss, you know, 11,000 miles away.
It's my belief that the majority of people in the city of Hudson do favor the cement plant.
My position is to protect the city of Hudson and to protect the residents should it be built. We're working on a host community agreement right now that will provide those safeguards and provide the city of Hudson with a fair share of money for the next 40 or 50 years in the future.
Politicians look at the St. Lawrence Cement Company as an opportunity to make money and bring more, you know, tax base to the area. It's short-sighted. And long run, it just doesn't help.
I'm just the opposite. Do you know the money that'll come in with that? The hotel business, the restaurant businesses, when the executives fly in, you gotta have a place to stay, a good place to have dinner.
Yeah, but how many executives are there? Three?
Well,
four? You know, I mean, you spend more money than they do.
Then they have breakdowns in the plants.
Engineers and things like that, yeah.
How are you gonna have a lot of jobs without industry? You tell me. Most of the jobs are service jobs now.
Right.
Think of it.
Bartenders, waitresses.
Mailmen.
You know, this big plant that they're proposing is like a gigantic step backwards. I know a lot of people preen for the old days. I mean, you know, the small town that has everything in it, you know, I mean, it's just not gonna happen anymore. But, you know, it's funny. I mean, you have the prostitution in Hudson, which was huge. I mean, it was like, that's what it was noted for. And then the cement plants, you know, it was noted for cement plants. And everybody goes, oh, the good old days of the cement plants, you know. And the good old days of prostitution. So do they want to bring back the prostitution too? You know, is that good old days? You know, it's like, what's the difference? You know what I mean?
My contention is that the city of Hudson's a lot better off with people, businesses that are locally owned, locally managed, that are invested here, where the shareholders live here, where the management lives here. If there's any vision at all, it's just that the community can create its own future, not let that be defined by St. Lawrence Cement or anybody else.
We moved to New York for a year, 90 we moved to Vermont for a year, and 91 we hit Provincetown. We were sort of escaping it all, and we were hoping to have, you know, some animals and a farm, and we did, we had it, and then all of a sudden we realized, oh my God, we're retired. We bought the building and worked on it for 6 months and opened as a puppet theater. It didn't go over that well here.
Basically, no one came.
We decided, oh my God, what do we have to make some money here. We better, let's turn it into a cabaret.
The ripples change their size, but never leave the stream of warm impermanence. So the days flow through my eyes, but still the days, they all seem the same. And these children...
I had been a performer my whole life, since I was teeny. Started with my cousins Teresa and Florette. They would dress me up on weekends in their communion gowns and parade me up and down the streets of Bangor, Maine. And it was, you know, I was probably quite a vision to the people of Bangor, but that got me hooked.
Time may change me, but you can't chase time.
it's going to be devastating for the area. If that cement plant was to be open here in Hudson, it will kill the business for Hudson. It will kill it because it will kill the real estate.
We believe that tourism and industry could coexist. You know, my grandfather worked in the Atlas cement plant. He moved up here when he was 14 years old, left Gates, North Carolina. He found something here, just like a lot of the, you know, the older people of color, they all worked at the cement plants. Everybody worked at the cement plants. Everybody had a job there, and everybody did well.
The SLC, or St. Lawrence Cement issue, for me, it's deeply personal. It's deeply personal. My father worked for a cement plant, and I, too, worked for a cement plant when I was going to college. It provided me with a great summer job and kept me off the streets and provided me with enough income to pay half of my tuition. And if I look at all of my friends' families who have done economically better in this town, all of their fathers worked at cement plants as well. And so in a town like Hudson, for people who have always lived here, you know, you can't say anything bad about a cement plant. It's almost like religion.
Did you forget what you keep? Yeah. Old age syndrome?
How you doing, man?
I'm pretty good, a little stiff.
Mine was a cement plant 18 years altogether. I started off as a laborer. I went to a control room operator. Then I went to a welder. And I thought it worked out very well for me. It enabled me to raise 3 kids and support my home and stuff and put me on my feet. So I thought it worked out very well. But the conditions was not good. A lot of heat, a lot of dust and stuff like that. Well, you really suffered. But I've seen times I get off from work and I couldn't hold my arms up because that's just like to have worn out there would be for not dehydrating in places. And like I say, it was a tough condition to work in, but like you never thought of that. You were trying to make all the money you could at that time, and then I would work 16 hours a day.
We used to go weeks without seeing you. We would hear his keys come in. We would hear his keys at night and his keys in the morning. And then I didn't realize exactly what was going on until I spent, what, 3 summers there?
Yeah.
You think it's the greatest thing since sliced bread when someone's telling you, you know, I'll pay you time and a half to start, and then I'll pay you double time for 4 hours, and then I'll pay you double time and a half. And you just start thinking to yourself, you know, I can deal with the dust. I can deal with the 130 degree temperature. I can wear this hard hat, these goggles, these steel-toed boots, these long sleeve shirts, the clinker taking the skin off my neck. You can deal with it for what amounts to $45 an hour. That's a great job for a person who might not have finished high school, $45 an hour.
And then the other boy, he finally went to a cement plant. He saw what it was all about.
He only did 1 summer. He couldn't take it.
1 summer was enough for him. Yeah. He said, Daddy, how do you work in a cement plant like that? I said, son, I had to do it to raise you. Yeah. It wasn't the best of health, but it was what at that time that was needed for my family.
Not good for your health. I mean, that's kind of an understatement. I mean, it was...
Yeah, a lot of my health was ruined. Yes, it was. But...
Yeah. Eyesight, hearing,
yeah, eyesight,
lungs.
Hearing, breathing. Those things, a lot to do with it.
They take a toll on you.
Huh?
They take a toll on you.
Yeah.
And I think if you look at the guys you worked with...
Well, a lot of the guys I work with is not here now. They was around the dust and stuff more than I was. Probably 3/4 of them are already gone.
On any given Sunday here at the restaurant, I mean, it's just a crowd of widows. And, you know, somebody who was fortunate enough to grow up with their father, I mean, I have to honestly say that it's great having him around, and I'm glad that he left when he did.
you know, this big St. Lawrence cement plant, I think there's absolutely no redeeming qualities to it at all.
Hey, Tom, how are you?
Very good, how's it going?
Good.
When I was a kid growing up, I developed asthma. I used to have to get shots once a week at a clinic down on Warren Street because I couldn't breathe. I mean, there were two huge, gigantic cement plants. And I can still remember the only good days that I had were days when it rained because there was no dust. You know, it kept the dust down. I mean, you would go to the playground, and I know everybody hears these stories, but you couldn't go down a slide. You'd get stuck halfway down the slide. I mean, with the cement dust and the trucks and all this kind of thing. And this plant is supposedly going to be 10 times bigger than these two plants. A lot of the folks who back it, you know, local politicians, I think they feel threatened by, you know, the new renaissance, and that, you know, it's almost a way for them to keep their political base and their power. You know, they're trying to play one side against the other when it should be the whole community working together for the betterment of the community.
Good news, the town of New Paltz to the rescue. The town of New Paltz has passed a resolution to oppose the coastal consistency determination sought by St. Lawrence Cement. Guess it passed, 5-0.
Well, that's fantastic.
I wish there were some way of...
Well, Friends of Hudson first came into being not around the cement plant issue, but there was a proposal to site a chemical processing plant down near the waterfront. A Canadian firm wanted to come in and basically process the sludge that you find in the dry cleaning process on our waterfront. And Sam Pratt had moved to town, and he very quickly organized a small group of citizens, about 30 or so.
And we, just through grassroots, door-to-door organizing, stopped that in about 4 or 5 months.
Great. Give me those. Let me pull up the file. Pull up a chair.
Our local officials seem to have known about St. Lawrence Cement long before any of us did. There were little rumors in Hudson, but I didn't really start getting the details about it until a rather astonishing meeting we had at the Columbia-Hudson Partnership one morning in 1999, when I and a couple of other activists were invited to this partnership meeting, and they said, well, you know, we're here today to talk about St. Lawrence Cement.
They have 2 full-time and 3 part-time.
The details of this project were just horrifying. Plant like this could generate emissions of mercury, arsenic, lead, and other, you know, heavy metals, that it would have a visible plume 6 miles long, you know, and the pollution could travel much farther.
That is 0 full-time jobs.
You know, many of us here felt it was fight or flight. Either we left because of the industrial threats to the area, or we stayed and we, you know, defended the town that we felt had so much promise.
Yeah, to become a member, you can make a donation of any size.
There's a photo booth where you write a message on a chalkboard to the governor and then get your picture taken, and we're going to mail these all to the governor.
And then you come in here and you surrender yourself naturally to the behemoth cement plant. Calculated pretty much in the dimensions and proportions.
Oh, the other thing, although I think we're out of dominoes, is that this domino is the same size as a 5'10" person. So people wrote their names in the back of the dominoes and then place the domino right at the base of the stack and see how much larger it would be in relation to them as a 6-foot-tall person.
We knew this company was going to spend everything they could to promote the project. The one weapon we had was that we lived here, and we just had to spend time to go out and talk to people. We did meetings in firehouses, we did meetings in church basements, we did meetings in private homes. It could be 3 people having coffee, or it could be 60 people. We would take any meeting we could get.
For those of you who may not be so familiar with it, St. Lawrence is based in Montreal, but is wholly controlled by Holcim, which is now the second largest cement company in the world. It was the first largest when we started all this.
By allowing a company, St. Lawrence, into our city and our county and our region, we would be ceding local control. This would become a company town, a company county. We found that all of the politicians in our communities have been extensively lobbied. You know, they were taking out tents at the Saratoga racetrack and inviting everybody up there to have free beer and a meal with them. It's really remarkable how little it takes to get goodwill from some of our local politicians. Yes?
When you have a company say that promises jobs to people, how do you address their concerns if they think that if they see it as someone trying to take jobs away at the environmental level?
One of the things we discovered, they don't put in their advertising, is that their own application reveals that there would only be one net new permanent job created by this project. You know, if this plant had been built in the 1940s or 50s, there'd be 2,000-3,000 people working in this plant. Now they need 130 people, largely people with specialized advanced degrees sitting in control rooms who are already in place. The company already has these people working for them. There's only a net of one new position available.
I think this issue is cast as a titanic struggle between the good blue-collar, hard-working folks of upstate New York against the latte-drinking, New York Times-reading folks who live out in the country and value their viewshed more than anything else. That is not the correct story. It's more complex than that, and there are many longtime residents of Hudson who remembered the impacts of the cement industry from the supposed good old days and who were supportive of us.
And who would have thought that a grassroots group from Columbia County could take on one of the largest multinationals in the world? But you have. And I don't know how long this battle is going to go on, but it could easily go on for several more years if St. Lawrence is going to drag it out until we get to a final decision. We're going to fight this, and we're going to win this by showing we can last longer than St. Lawrence. And this is truly...
Past 26 months, we have met numerous times with St. Lawrence Cement hammering out several versions of the host community agreement. Today we have a contract in its most recent version.
Comments?
I've been a member of the Economic Council since host negotiations first began. St. Lawrence has agreed to the benefit of the city in every instance. So let's get on with the vote and do our duty for the city.
First, I would like to say thank everybody for coming out. It's good to have people come and comment. I believe that this agreement is in the best interest of the city, and I support it wholeheartedly. We should do what we need to do to pass this agreement.
I also back Quentin on that. I think we've been too long on this. Every time you have a meeting, then the people throws up more stuff. It keeps on adding on and on. I think It's time to vote, like Quentin says.
You know, as far as this goes, I walk through my community quite often, and I'm voting on the majority of my community, and right now, the majority of the people that I hear from are in favor of it.
Okay, I'm gonna open up to the floor.
The germane subject is this a good deal for Hudson? You bet your life it is. Over a 20-year period, we're talking $4 million projected for the city treasury. There hasn't been an offer of this type made anywhere in Columbia County over the past several decades. My support is 100% for it. Iron out the clinkers, if there are any, and sign it, and take it before the train leaves the station.
My name is Linda Musser, and I live right over there on State Street. I want to remind you that the future of our city is at stake, and the state is still reviewing St. Lawrence Cement proposal, and has not come to a conclusion. So how can you possibly come to any kind of agreement at this time? I also want you to remember that this agreement does not include any comments about burning of tires and hazardous waste, which this company does do in other communities. And one last comment, I want to remind you that Mayor Scalera accepted campaign contributions from St. Lawrence Cement during his past campaign for mayor. If Mayor Scalera is the negotiator of this document, then there is a serious conflict of interest in this procedure.
I went on the internet just before I came over here, and I typed in host community agreement. I was curious to see what other communities may have gotten in similar circumstances. The town of Niagara Falls, New York has a gambling casino run by the Seneca Indians. They get $9.5 million a year. Now, I offer that only to demonstrate what a cheesy deal we're being offered. There's a lot less impact from a gambling casino than there is from the proposed cement plant.
Thank you.
Sir?
I'd like to say, gentlemen, it's 26 months. This county, the city of Hudson, the county, needs jobs, and more work and less occupied hands is going to fill the jails less. Amen.
I work in Hudson, but I live in Athens. And Athens, you may know, is the host community to another major corporation, the Athens Generating Company. They were permitted, and they were permitted on the basis that they would not have any visible plumes. Any of you who live in Hudson today, on most days this winter, can look out the window and see 1, 2, and 3 plumes from Athens. And the town of Athens has no recourse. So I urge you to demand that your guests behave properly, and also don't rush into this. Every corporation that tries to develop something in any host community tries to get an agreement. They tried to get it early, and they tried to get it cheap. Don't sell out this city's future cheaply. Thank you.
I think you should be in favor of this. There's not a pollution problem because the state will take care of that. They won't cite them if there is. Thank you.
I feel that this project should go forward, and I think with the host agreement, we all should accept it and appreciate it. Thank you. Let's move forward, Mike.
I would really like to understand why you folks feel that it is necessary at this moment to make this decision. This intelligent gentleman, a lawyer, an intelligent gentleman who has something important to say, and there are other people here, okay, that...
Remember what I asked, just respect.
Exactly. Well, I'm asking for respect as well, because I'm asking you to respect us, and I don't understand what it is that, how does it benefit you all by making this decision right now? Wait until you have the information. If you're bored with this, well, I'm really sorry, I'm bored with it too. It's your job, okay? And it's our job as citizens to get what's right for us. So please, just like, slow down.
I keep hearing about what's the rush, and I believe that based on the conversations that we had with St. Lawrence, I believe this is an agreement that is a take it or leave it proposition based on the fact that we have negotiated back and forth over 26 months, and every time we think we have an agreement in place, Well, nobody's ever satisfied with it. And so at this particular point, we think this is the best that we can come with. And
I believe that our bargaining position, if it goes to that extent, is far stronger than you gentlemen have taken for granted. I don't believe that SLC is going to walk away from a 100-year supply of raw material, which they already own. I don't believe it for one minute. They'll sit and they'll negotiate and they'll pay more. We're talking about a deal here that's a $300 million plant. And I think they've got a brain trust going to work for them, as opposed to the council and its attorney. With all due respect, gentlemen, I think it's like Hudson High against the New York Yankees.
The medical staff of our hospital studied the proposal, and here was their statement. They said that this plant would be a serious risk to our community's health. Increased death rates expected for people with advanced heart and lung disease, increased cancer rates, and worsening asthma in children.
We didn't want the subject.
No, this is the subject. The health of our community is the subject, Mike. This agreement withdraws you from the adjudicatory process. As you said in your own letter, it gives up rights today, not at the end of the process, today.
How can you trust any major corporation in this country? You can't. They will lie to you and they will steal from you. They are not to be trusted. And I don't know how you can trust them.
Are you a citizen of the United States? Oh,
it doesn't matter. He can pay taxes.
Hey, man.
He's a legal alien, sir.
Hey, man.
Would you like to have him deported?
Yes.
Please. Now that's out of order. That is out of order. That's out of order. You don't have a right to speak. He did.
Let's make it any corporation in the world.
Thank you.
We're all here saying how we feel about this proposal. And if there is someone here from St. Lawrence Cement, I would really appreciate that person standing up and telling us why he thinks this is such a good deal.
Yeah, I'd like to hear from that person too, St. Lawrence Cement.
St. Lawrence, come on!
All right, okay, everyone. This is not the time for that.
There is a majority of members of the Common Council that feel that there's such a sense of urgency that we need to pass this ASAP. The problem is it hasn't given us a chance as an elected body to discuss these issues back and forth with one another.
All right, the meeting is adjourned and we're going to postpone the vote for further discussion.
Totally. As long as you're leading the cause, you don't have.
You're a Christian. You know.
No, I dislike you. I dislike you, Sam. I dislike you, Sam. To the tenth degree.
The best thing that people do here is pit one group against another group, and I think the cement plant debate has really made a huge division in our community, and I think it makes everybody feel. It sort of brings the worst out in everybody. That's what St. Lawrence Cement has done for us.
They have come to this community and done everything they can to divide old, longtime residents from newcomers, to divide straight from gay, to divide in any way they can, to create an exaggerated sense of divisiveness in the community, and I resent the hell out of it.
And recently, people walking by yelling faggot, and you know, they're not yelling faggot at gay people.
They don't even know what they're yelling.
You know, they're just yelling it. And I believe that's a product of the horrible divide and conquer strategy of the cement, St. Lawrence Cement.
We all were divided, arguing, you know, constant bickering. We're wasting our resources on something like this when we could be using that on education, on programs, on economic development. We're spending millions of dollars in here when we could be using it on our kids, you know, to fight the war on drugs. And I think it's, you know, shameful on both our parts, on everybody's part.
You know, as I think about it, in many ways, I think SLC is symbolic. That people are using it because for the people who feel like this nation has failed them, the people who have watched their job go to Mexico or Singapore, the people who have felt like There's no one fighting for them. I think SLC has kind of come in and become, you know, their hero. And so they're lined up on the other side, not because they personally will benefit from it, because there's only so many jobs this place can offer, but because it's almost, this is if they're embracing a victory against a group of people they know nothing about.
I'm Jake, Walt. It's a pleasure to meet you. Welcome, welcome.
That was one of the reasons my wife and I decided to open Jubilee, you know, that central meeting place for people who normally wouldn't have crossed paths. Not come together to discuss problems, but just come together to understand the past that each has, understand how, you know, we look at the world, understand, you know, really just each other as people.
Blessed are the peacemakers.
Blessed are the peacemakers.
For my wife, Shandia and I, this was probably the single largest investment we've ever made, but this is not about enriching us in an economic way. It's about looking back on it 5 years from now and saying, this was one of the things that helped bridge the gap that never should have existed in the first place.
Feed them so we can get back to up here. You'll cause trouble.
Here, Rudy. Let's see.
We'll have tuna and cod.
Tuna and cod. You're gonna love that.
Here, Momo. Up here. There, it worked like a charm. This will get him going.
Yeah.
Mmm.
Okay.
Okay.
Hey, Moo. I'll take tigers into her, too.
You like the
Buster deer. Dundee, where are you?
Oh, shoot, he went upstairs. Here, Percy, you eat here. Stop. There's Percy.
Percy, take your time.
Here you go. Here you go.
Concentrate, you Percy.
Here you go. 18 pounds later.
Oh, he's...
I know, he's a kitten.
He's a growing cat.
Now he's eating tigers.
Well, we did the best we could.
Tiger, come in here.
We got the majority fed, right?
Oh.
Hey, you go ahead, Claudia. Okay. You go, I'll shut the door.
No, I'll shut the door. What? What, Rudy?
Claudia and I come from rural America. I was born in Gary, Indiana, and Claudia in the South in Georgia. I was in 4-H Club. I was raised in the Lutheran Church. I was loved intensely and endlessly. I was a product of World War II. A lot of the potluck suppers and school and, you know, the church was part of our life. And when we went to the big city, New York City, we were totally divorced from that existence. I think our generation left our homes to have access to our dreams. And when our dreams were fulfilled and age and economics changed, coming to Hudson in many ways was like coming home.
Oh, look at that.
And moving to a community like this, a lot of the sort of community issues were very easy for Claudia and I because it was part of our life.
I guess we can throw it.
Okay.
We can use like a standard measure, like we use a cup.
A measure?
We're gonna make a Moroccan stew.
Wow. Oh my goodness, look at this.
You can slice these in half, and I'll be around helping you. Does anyone have a knife? Safely?
Yes. And then we'll put this here, and we can just...
them decorative? All the way around.
This idea of health and education is something that's gotten lost. I mean, I don't have children, and I'm very interested in children. And I think whatever happened, the children seemed to take a backseat. When I grew up, children were always first.
Today has truly been a special day here. And all of you young cooks, it's wonderful. So welcome, and Linda, do you have something to say?
Just thanks for everybody for being involved. I grew up on a farm. We ate together three times a day. And I believe that people should sit down and eat together and know each other and set the table and wash the dishes and cut the food. Thank you so much. You're the best part of being in Hudson, New York.
Living in a democracy and being in the democracy spirit on a daily basis is my dream. And when I watch the religious right, the conservative, whatever, all those labels, we're all after the same thing, and we all want those values somehow to be part of our life. And in a small community like Hudson, you can do that. You actually have some kind of ability to check out whether that works.
Snipe. Chilling. This is my ward. I grew up in these buildings in 1C right here. It was a junkyard. This whole section was a junkyard. But yeah, this is my community. I used to hang out down here all the time as a kid. Me and my friends, we used to come down here and play tag and hide and go seek and walk down to the train checks. This is where I'm from. And, I wouldn't leave here for anything. I'd probably be here for the rest of my life. Even if I go to work somewhere else, this would always be my permanent home. This is my fourth year in office, actually, and it's time for a re-election. So yeah, it's pretty interesting, pretty interesting. I'm the new wave. I'm the next generation of a politician. I guess I'm not in the establishment. I'm trying to do real things and let the people know that I feel your pain. I'm right here with you. I live in the same projects that you do. I'm working the same type of jobs that you do, but it doesn't have to stop there. You know, education is the key, you know, upward mobility, you know, getting what you need to be successful. And that's what I'm doing, you know. It's a work in progress. My opinion of St. Lawrence Cement has not changed at this point, but I'm gonna sit and listen, and I'm gonna listen to people. That's one thing I know I probably haven't done, you know, being on the other side and just being aligned with Rick Scalera. I haven't listened to the other side's opinion, but from now on, I will. I'm gonna listen, and I'll make my decision from there.
Come on, sure, like sure. This. I
want to tell you stories
that you ought to know. I'm not saying about the high
rise.
What's up, Clint?
What's going on?
All right, what's up,
man?
All right,
how's
life?
It's good.
All right, that's good. How's the Belgian sisters?
Good. How's your birthday go?
Oh, my birthday was nice. I went to New Rochelle, went to the Black Amusement Park, went to the museum to check out the Black Madonna. It was very educational. Me and my pastor, Reverend Singletary, and my family, it was very wonderful and an uplighting experience. So therefore, after that, we came back and we went out to dinner at Applebee's.
Yeah, I was there last night.
Living good in the neighborhood.
What do you think about Scalera?
What I think about Scalab? Okay, your opinion is your opinion and mine is mine. If not, why does salt and pepper go nice so nice if variety was not the spice of life, you know? You know what I'm saying? But I think Scalab has dropped the ball. Straight up. He's dropped the ball. He's lost contact with this community. You know, he doesn't live here. He doesn't seem to care about the disenfranchised, and he doesn't care about those that have to have somewhere to stay. And I'm not saying that he's taking payoffs, but things have gotten too far. There's no way in the world that people like this can ever get out of the low-income housing, because there's just not that much money to be saved. Mm-hmm. You work hard, sometimes you work two jobs and you have a spouse that works. That's three jobs and no one can get out of here because you're locked in to a demographic disadvantage. They call it disenfranchised. But we have a dream and we're gonna make this dream work. We will have inclusion, like I said before. I'm tired of it, and it's that time of the year, the next election, we will make a change. For little guys like this, we want to leave them something better. Mm-hmm. This is our dream, this is our legacy. We have to leave our children better than we have what they're trying to do here. Otherwise, they'll be locked in this, you know, and there's bigger and better things. Bigger and better things. Did you agree?
I agree. Nice talking to you.
Okay, brother, we'll see.
Yeah.
Hi, this is Alan Chartok in the Community Corner with Mayor Rick Scalera, mayor of the city of Hudson, nicknamed the Friendly City.
Hi there. How are you?
Hi.
Are you a Democrat or Republican, Mayor?
Depends on who you ask. I'm a Democrat. How are you?
You've had political opposition before in the town. There have been some pretty contested races. Why is that?
People want my job.
Our mayor in Hudson, who we've been trying to get rid of for years, this time around went to party committees of each of the four major parties on the ballot and has been endorsed by all four major parties. People say there's no difference between Democrats and Republicans. Well, in Hudson, there's apparently no difference between Democrats, Republicans, conservatives, and Independence Party members.
It's politics, and people grew up together, and you know, one hand washes the other. And some strange things happen.
You know what they do? They go behind closed doors and pass sneaky things like the $60,000 pay and try to squeeze through the four-year mayor, do all that stuff, promise you a job, this guy a job, you help me and I'll wash your back, and they keep that good old boy network going.
Sometimes it's scary. You got the cement plant coming in. You got a mayor who's created a one-party town. You've got a lot of black kids who don't see a lot of hope, and their only future is probably working on Third and State selling drugs. And you got an educational system that really is not the best in the world. And so with all that, I mean, how do you have hope?
I'm Linda Musselman. I'm running for mayor of Hudson. You know that? Have you heard that?
No, I haven't.
Well, now you're hearing it right here.
Will I be a good mayor? I don't know. I've never been a mayor before. Rick Scalera has.
Really, the time is short before the primary. It's a lot of very basic work that needs to be done. Every day is going to start counting.
I mean, it's a cliche at this point, but you know, democracy doesn't work unless people are actively involved in the democratic process.
Are you a Hudson voter?
To make the system operate the way we were told it operated in, you know, sixth grade civics class.
This is Linda. Linda's running for mayor.
How are you?
Hi, Linda.
This is Bobby Renard.
Bobby Renard.
Linda Musselman.
What are you up to, Bobby?
Looking for a home.
Oh, yeah? Well, you. Welcome to Hudson. I'm sure there's a nice place here for you.
Where else?
Stay here, Ms. Musselman. And good luck to you.
Thank you very much.
I wish you the best.
All right. Thanks.
Hi there.
Hi.
How you guys doing?
Okay.
How are you?
Pleased to meet you.
I've done it for, I was an alderman for 4 years. I was a police commissioner. I've been little league coaches, football coaches. So I've been involved in this community all my life. There's nothing more than I want is than the success of this community.
What's going on politically is people from the city have a voice here.
Yeah. And so now they want to be involved in politics. And that's their right. They can do that. You know, but I'm not with that.
This is our town, and we're going to keep it this way. We were born and raised here, and that's the way it is. We want to bring Hudson back to Hudson. She's not getting Hudson.
You know, this business of, you know, behind closed doors, you know, this is the way it's always been done. It's not working anymore.
I'm interested in getting a lot of power in a lot of hands. And whether you can achieve that anymore in America, I don't know. Let's try. Come on over. There's a long history of keeping people out of government process in this community. And if there's anybody that is an alternative, it's me in every way. And I'm a difficult, rowdy candidate. I'm not everybody's cup of tea, so.
Half of the people that's up in this area, they got mixed feelings. It was for the,
Rick Flair?
Yeah.
Let's go over there. Here. Let's see, because there's more people in here.
Come on, Alan.
How you doing?
You probably can talk to them.
So, Homer, why don't you talk about your neighborhood? Give us some ideas. Homer's a supporter of Rick Scalera, so you'll be hearing the other side, the other point of view.
What do you want to know about it?
Whatever you experience here, living here, how you feel about it.
How I feel about it? You don't want me to tell you how I feel about
it. Oh, Homer, you know, I love your honesty.
I don't know. What you going to do for the city of Hudson? Now you want to get on that subject.
What am I going to do for the city of Hudson? What I've been doing. Come on out here. We need to, you know, we need to get this conversation going. We need
for the truth.
Yeah, we need the truth.
The politicians now that are in charge are for self, not for community.
As being the mayor, the town of Hudson, you rule it. Not the police station, not the lawyers and stuff. The mayor is the boss of Hudson.
And the mayor is voted in by the people.
They figured that hardworking people in the community don't have no say-so. And some of the rich aristocrat, they think that downtown is a slum. It's not a slum.
Yeah.
And one time before in the meeting, said, well, tear down high-rise. Why tear it down? What you gonna tear it down for? People live there. Where are all those people going if they tear it down?
That's right.
Okay?
Scalera, we gotta change this place.
Only problem, nobody's knowing about her. Like, I didn't know. I heard pretty bad things about her.
Well, every time I go campaigning near Bliss Towers, the rumor spins. And Rick Scalera has accused me of wanting to tear Bliss Towers down, and that's a patent lie.
You're saying, and gossip and rumor and innuendo.
So if you were not the one that wanted to blow up the high-rise, why didn't you defend yourself when it was...
I did. I went down there. I said that I didn't say that. I'm telling you the truth. I am. I'm right here in the hot sun. I have nothing to lose by telling the truth. I have everything to gain. Why shouldn't they talk bad about me? Because I'm asking too many questions. I'm challenging the old boys. You get that, right?
Yeah. Right. Well,
we're going to win. We are going to win, and you guys can help me. If we can do it together, I can't do it alone. You've got to help me. You've got to help me. You've got to help me. You've got to help me.
Now, it's my fifth time around, and I never take anything for granted. This is such a small community where everybody knows everybody. It doesn't matter if you're Republican or Democrat. Pretty much it's name recognition, and you can't get away with the old Corning days where you win, you know, basically you win 40 consecutive years in a row by building a machine, as he did up in Albany. We have a sputtering machine here. You never know where it's going to go from year to year. We hang on with our fingernails, basically.
Mrs. Morrison, right?
Morrison.
Morrison.
So are these hot dogs are paid for by Rick Scalera? I'm not sure whether I can in good faith eat this hot dog.
Okay. How are you?
I hope you're warm for me today.
Okay.
Well, there's too many people, line, big line, but they're
now
not doing.
There's nobody?
Not good, not okay. good.
So my All young right. man.
Who are you gonna vote for when you're 18? That's right. There you go. That's right.
All right. I'm getting used to this idea of actually being this thing that I've never been. Being a part of the process of the Vietnam War, that I spent a long time protesting and being against. And what I'm asking people now, I'm asking people and myself, let's be for something, let's be for this change, and let's be the change.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, Betty, they're saying you didn't register as a Democrat. You just registered without marking it. All right, I might come over there with her.
Hey, Annie. Hi, Rick Scalera. Are you going to need a ride?
Yeah, Joanne. Gotcha. You're going to be going out to vote yet tonight?
I'm going to go get Amy Sweet and Bruce Hall. They're right next to each other.
Barnett?
You want me to come? I can have somebody come over and get you.
Okay. Anybody know Mary Hotelling?
He's the fourth ward.
Yes. He's walking out with these people, and I hear, well, they must be on Mussman's team because she looks like a dyke.
It's been pretty rough down here.
40, 41. We're trying to squeeze out the last 100 votes. Between 7:15 and 9 o'clock.
The largest volume of votes is in the unknown maybe column, so you don't know. Is it 50-50?
What's 32% of both of these?
Uh-huh.
Add them together, add them onto here.
All right, I've got to do some addition here.
It's now 8:20. The number is 671-6466. Your vote has never been more important than it is tonight.
We're getting down. We've got about another 30 minutes. Is he up there? Dark up there. He's on the train from New York. He may make it.
5-2, you ready?
Ready.
Me, 198, her, 113.
Linda, 22, Scalera, 25.
175, 179.
Oh, man.
117 to 180. Okay, what's common council?
Right, but we got two
that's
more words.
That's a big difference.
The first one.
It's gonna be really close. Very close here. Not as good news. Not good news, I don't think.
Okay. Well, it's hard to handicap to be on the bottom.
Not counting absentees and without the first ward results, it's probably impossible to pick up 337 votes in the first ward. Which would put Rick up by 327 votes.
Thank you, thank you. All of you, I can't thank you enough. My heart is not broken. I do not consider this a loss. I consider it yet one more victory on the way to change. And we have new council members. We have a whole new group of people voting and working toward a dream. And the dream cannot stop. It will not stop. This is obviously not the end, but yet a beginning and a beginning and a beginning and a beginning to changing the way the city runs. It is the people's government. We have to keep working toward making this the people's government. And we have proven that the people have rallied and are continuing to move to make this an inclusive and embracing and compassionate city of people who want to live together, work together to change, to make a difference. I'm only a block or two from City Hall. We'll be there, we'll be watching, we'll be waiting to plan our next efforts, which are endlessly, endlessly interesting. Thank you all.
Balloons are up. There are 9 balloons that are lofted or in place right now up at the quarry. There's one more that's being inflated as we speak down the waterfront.
The balloon launch is being required by the Department of State for New York. DOS requested SLC to fly these balloons so that they could see firsthand what the visual impacts would be.
We're concentrating the investigation within this 5-mile radius. This is the outline of the plant. When we link a computer-generated image to the balloons, we should be able to drop it in with a lot of accuracy.
And this is a zoom.
Yeah, it's at sort of 70 to 210. I didn't even look.
And I have a digital.
I would urge you all, while being very fair and objective, to also be thinking creatively about where else could I go to take a shot.
Is someone doing Dutchman's Landing?
Both south, looking north.
Okay, good luck, everybody.
Good luck, happy shooting.
If you're patient and wait for the balloons to hit the vertical, to see the full extent of this massive plant, and we believe the visual impact alone is grounds to deny permits to St. Lawrence.
That's a really famous house.
7th of the yellow.
I can
yellow.
See 8 actually.
42 degrees, 15.799 minutes.
All right, the balloons are starting to come up above the trees, but let's go a little further west. Stand by for some photos. Got one digital, and you can see the extent, the width of the facility. You're not just seeing one stack. This is a whole factory looming above the ridge line.
That's the problem with the balloon test, is you've got these little dots, but if you fill them in your mind, you're looking at a huge thing right along that ridge.
Said so, now and forever I vote no.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Sheehan.
Aye.
Ankowski. No. Carter. No. Hughes.
I abstain.
Keneally.
No.
O'Brien.
I vote no.
Riley.
Thank my aldermen for their thoroughness, and I vote no.
Incredibly gratifying for myself, for Sam, for the board of directors, for all the other members, to not only be celebrating a victory, but to be celebrating a community.
Well, question of someone raised the other day, and he said, what do you think the turning point was? What was the moment when we began to win? Because remember, it really looked very grim early on, very grim. And if I could be corny for a moment, I think we started winning when each of us, in our minds, decided that this community was important enough to fight for, and that we each felt strongly enough to care enough to fight for it. Because you can't stop something unless you're fighting for something. And that's what we each did, and that's why we won. So thank you, and let's celebrate.
Now that SLC is gone, hopefully we can figure out how not to let the next issue get in the way of this town be really healing itself. So I'm hopeful that that's the next chapter of this town. I hope it's unity. I hope it's trying to figure out, you know, how to bring these people together. I think we've all got to figure out ways. People who are in business, you know, elected officials, the churches. There really is an opportunity for this community to right itself.
Now that the SLC victory is behind us, we really think it's important to take all the energy that went into that fight to work for positive ends. Friends of Hudson is going to stick together both as a continued watchdog for the area and to promote the type of greener, cleaner, more sustainable development that we think will create the jobs that everybody wants and needs while maintaining the character of the area and the quality of life that we think everybody needs to participate in.
St. Lawrence cement was something that created a class war in the city. But it's not, you know, the new people's fault that, you know, the housing market is out of whack. It's just the way our society works. It's, you know, capitalism. It's not anybody's fault, but it will be our fault if we don't do anything about it, because we have the resources to say, okay, now that St. Lawrence is gone, you know, we still need to bring some jobs in. You know, let's bring some safe, healthy, environmental friendly jobs in here. You know, the community needs to talk. And we as people who are local or are elected need to stop in the divisiveness for our own, you know, political purposes and say, no, enough is enough. Let's work together.
People in this community really do love Hudson, and they do appreciate the environment, and they want to see good things. And good things happen in all different forms.
I mean, I wanted to run for mayor, and I figured out how to do that. And I could do that here, and it was the most exciting thing I've ever done in my life. And it wasn't about winning or losing. It was about the process of doing that, a very revolutionary, very American thing that you can only do in America. And that Claudia and I could come along and buy this building, set up something that will go beyond our lifetime. Something bigger than us is extremely part, I think that's part of the American dream that, I don't know, where one gets those ideas.
It's just something special that you really don't know until you actually live it, until you actually, you know, have been brought up with it. But, you know, there's nothing matter with a small town. A small town is a great thing, you know. It should be preserved. It's like a, you know, kind of a thing that's close to extinction, I think. But, I mean, there's really a sense of community in Hudson, and I think, you know, that the people are going to take it back.